Hey there guys, Paul here from the engineeringmindset.com. In this video, we're going to be covering essential chiller terms. Now these are terms that you will hear engineers say when they talk about chillers, and they will expect you to understand exactly what they mean by this. So by the end of this video, you can be fluent in chiller terminology. Now we're going to cover a lot in a very short amount of time, so I advise that you do not skip this video and that you also make notes as we go through. We'll cover the basics of each, and if you want to learn more, then you can check the links in the video description below. Just before we get started, I want to take a moment to thank our partner Danfoss for sponsoring this video. Danfoss wants to help you build higher quality, longer lasting and more efficient chillers, and they have a wide range of solutions to make that possible. In fact, they have up to 70% of the products you need for your chiller systems, including compressors, AC drives, system protectors, heat exchangers, valves, electronics, and even sensors. It doesn't matter what kind of chiller you're working with, Danfoss have products that can help you boost performance, increase reliability and reduce the impact on the environment. All of these solutions come together to help you design and create better chillers from the inside out. You can get started by heading over to chillers.danfoss.com. Refrigeration cycle. This is the process of how refrigerant moves around the inside of the chiller or any refrigeration system. The compressor is the driving force of the refrigerant. The refrigerant leaves the compressor as a high pressure, high temperature gas and moves to the condenser. The condenser cools the refrigerant and rejects the thermal energy into the atmosphere. The refrigerant then leaves the condenser as a high pressure liquid. The refrigerant then heads to the expansion device, which reduces the pressure, and the refrigerant becomes a low pressure liquid vapor mixture. The refrigerant then passes through the evaporator, where the unwanted heat of the building is added. This boils the refrigerant into a low pressure vapor. As it evaporates, it takes with it the unwanted heat, which the compressor then sucks in to repeat the cycle. Refrigerant. This is a specially designed fluid which moves around the inside of the chiller, collecting the unwanted heat from the evaporator and moving this over to the condenser so that the heat can be rejected from the building. It changes states between liquid and gas during the refrigeration cycle. It is moved around the chiller by the compressor. The refrigerant stays within the chiller and is always kept separate from the condenser water and the chilled water. The refrigerants will have strange names such as R134A, R1233ZD, etc., etc. Condenser. This is where the unwanted heat of the building is rejected to the atmosphere, either through an air-cooled or water-cooled condenser. The refrigerant, which carries the unwanted heat from the evaporator over to the condenser, will enter as a high-pressure, high-temperature gas, and as the thermal energy is rejected, it will leave as a high-pressure liquid. Condenser water. This is the water that flows between the cooling tower and the condenser of a water-cooled chiller. This picks up all the unwanted heat in the condenser, which was transferred over via the refrigerant. It also collects the heat from the compressor in certain designs. The condenser water is sent to the cooling tower where the heat is removed and rejected to atmosphere, and it then returns back to the condenser to pick up more heat. A typical temperature would be a flow 32 degrees Celsius or 89.6 degrees Fahrenheit and a return of 27 degrees Celsius or 80.6 Fahrenheit. Now these numbers are just typical and they can and will vary from this. Air-cooled. This refers to an air-cooled chiller. These are located outside the building, usually on the roof or down near the car park, etc. Very rarely these are located inside the building, but they can be fitted with ductwork to achieve this. These types of chillers do not use condenser water circuits. They instead use fans to blow air across the condenser, which is why they are called air-cooled chillers. Water-cooled. This refers to a type of chiller which uses the condenser water and cooling towers to remove the heat from the condenser. These are located inside the building, typically in the basement. Evaporator. The evaporator is where the unwanted heat of the building is collected before being transferred over to the condenser. As the unwanted heat enters the evaporator, it will cause the refrigerant to boil and evaporate inside. As it evaporates, it will carry the heat away over to the condenser. The refrigerant enters the evaporator as a low pressure liquid, and as it evaporates, it will leave as a low pressure vapor. Chilled water. The chiller generates chilled water. This chilled water will flow in a closed circuit between the chiller's evaporator and the cooling coils within the building. A pump will force the chilled water around the building to the coils within the air handling units and the fan coil units, where the unwanted heat in the air will be transferred over into the water. This cools the air down and warms the chilled water up. This warm chilled water then returns to the chiller's evaporator, where it will dump its unwanted heat. As the heat is dumped, it causes the refrigerant to boil and carry this heat away, which causes the water to cool down again. Once it is cooled down, it will be pumped around the building to repeat the cycle and collect more heat. A typical temperature of the chilled water are a flow of 6 degrees Celsius or 42.8 degrees Fahrenheit and a return of 12 degrees Celsius or 53.6 degrees Fahrenheit. These numbers can and will vary from this though. One pass, two pass, and three pass. This refers to a water-cooled evaporator or condenser and the way that the water or refrigerant is piped through this component. In a one pass, the fluid will pass straight through, but for greater heat transfer, the tubes can be looped back on itself one or two times to increase the transfer time and the surface area. This will allow more heat to transfer over. Compressor. This moves the refrigerant around the chiller to collect the unwanted heat from the evaporator and move it over to the condenser. Some of the different designs you can get for chillers are centrifugal type, which uses a rotating impeller to induce a centrifugal force on the refrigerant, which forces it around the system. Turbocore, which is a more advanced variation of the centrifugal type. It uses two small rotating impellers to compress the refrigerant. Screw type, which uses two helical rotating screws to squeeze the refrigerant into a tighter space and thus compresses it. Scroll type, which uses two spiral discs, one is stationary and the other one rotates to compress the refrigerant and squeeze it into a smaller space. Reciprocating type, which uses pistons and cylinders to compress the refrigerant into a smaller volume. Cooling tower, often referred to simply as just the tower, these sit on the outside of the building, usually on the roof, and are only used with water-cooled chillers. They will be either wet or dry type, but both types use fans to move air through the tower. With wet type, the condenser water circuit is open and the water is sprayed into the airstream, which removes the heat and cools the water down. In a dry type, the condenser circuit is closed and the water passes through a heat exchanger where the airstream blows across this to remove the heat. Additionally, some cooling towers will spray water over the cooling coils to help remove the heat. Hot gas bypass. Now this is only used on some chillers. It is used to create an artificial cooling load to stop the chiller from cycling, stalling, surging, as well as protecting the evaporator from freezing under low load conditions. A control valve is used along with a pressure reducing valve to recirculate hot refrigerant from the compressor discharge line and send it straight to the inlet of the evaporator, thus bypassing the condenser so that heat is added to the evaporator to create a false load. This is a pretty inefficient strategy. The energy that went into the compression of the refrigerant will provide no usable cooling effect. If you're using this strategy, then your chiller is likely way oversized. COP. COP stands for the coefficient of performance. It's simply a ratio of how much cooling you get per unit of electricity you put in, which is a way of measuring the chiller's efficiency. To calculate COP, it's simply the kilowatts of refrigeration divided by the kilowatts of electricity. For example, 2,500 kilowatts of cooling divided by 460 kilowatts of electricity equals a COP of 5.4. So for every 1 kilowatt of electricity you put into the chiller, it will generate 5.4 kilowatts of cooling. It is useful for measuring the efficiency at a specific point in time under specific conditions. Motor starter. Large chillers, especially those with single compressors such as centrifugal type, can have enormous inrush currents when the motor starts. This means a large flow of power through the building's electrical system and into the chiller. This can cause damage to the electrical infrastructure and deteriorates the equipment. You might have experienced this when the compressor of a fridge in your house turns on and all the lights dip for a split second. To combat this, chillers will use motor starters, which limit the inrush power as the motor starts. These are either built into the compressor, or they're housed in a case on the chiller, or they're housed remotely nearby the chiller. There are many different methods used to achieve this. Variable speed drive or VFD. Some chillers will use variable speed drives. This effectively does the job of a soft starter, but they also control the speed of the compressor to allow it to operate more efficiently at part load conditions, which can lead to large energy savings. They will, however, result in a reduction in efficiency at full load conditions, although chillers typically only operate 1 to 2% of the year at full load. VFDs can also be fitted to pumps to help save energy and allow the pumps to change the flow rate to better match the cooling demand, typically using a pressure sensor to control the speed. Rated load amps or RLA. RLA refers to the maximum amps drawn by the compressor's motor during the operation. The RLA will vary depending on how much work the compressor has to do. If the RLA is exceeded, then the compressor motor can overheat and destroy itself. There are safety features built into the chiller's controls to measure and prevent this from occurring. For example, a 1,272 kilowatt rated centrifugal type water-cooled chiller has an RLA of 359 amps, but the chiller will cut the power to the motor if it reaches 455 amps. This limit and value will vary between chillers and manufacturer. Load. Load refers to the cooling demand on the chiller. Full load means that the chiller is operating at its maximum cooling capability, but this is only for around 1 to 2% of the year typically. Part load means the chiller is operating at less than its maximum capability. This is normal for most of the year in a typical application. Low load means that the chiller is operating at very low capacity. Faults can often occur at these conditions, and chillers typically do not operate very efficiently at these conditions. If a chiller is operating at low load for long periods throughout the year, then it is likely oversized and alternative options should be investigated to replace it. This will save energy as well as operating costs. Cooling load is typically measured in BTUs, refrigeration tons, or kilowatts. Cooling demand. When the chilled water is pumped from the chiller's evaporator around the building to collect unwanted heat, it returns back at a higher temperature. The amount of water flowing and the temperature will determine the cooling demand. For example, a flow rate of 0.0995 cubic meters per second with a flow temperature of 6 degrees Celsius and a return of 12 degrees Celsius will result in the cooling demand of around 2,500 kilowatts or 710 refrigeration tons. Capacity. This refers to how much cooling the chiller is designed to provide at maximum load. The capacity can be controlled in most chillers so that it closely matches the actual cooling demand at the current time. The capacity is usually measured in units of kilowatts or refrigeration tons. Relief valves. Relief valves and lines are fitted to chillers to protect the components and operators from a dangerous amount of pressure buildup within the chiller from the refrigerant. It is rare that this scenario occurs, but it is possible. This might occur, for instance, in the case of a fire. Typically, the chiller will use a spring-loaded valve which opens automatically if the refrigerant pressure is more than the spring pressure. This will allow the refrigerant to safely vent to atmosphere and the valve will close again once it reaches a lower pressure. Fouling. This refers to the buildup of dirt and organic substances on the surface of heat exchangers, which effectively insulates the surfaces and reduces the heat exchanger's ability to transfer heat. This is very common in the condenser of a water-cooled chiller because of the open circuit which permits dirt and bacteria to enter the pipework. Good water treatment and monitoring over time should be implemented to reduce this. Chillers are designed to withstand a certain amount of fouling under normal operating conditions, but if this is exceeded, then the chiller will be unable to reach its design capacity. Lift. Lift refers to the difference in pressure between the refrigerant in the condenser and the refrigerant in the evaporator. The higher the difference, the more work the compressor is having to do in order to achieve this. The chilled and condenser water temperatures and the approach temperatures set the required lift. Reducing the condenser water set point and increasing the chilled water set point will reduce the energy consumption of the compressor. Approach temperature. This refers to the temperature difference between the chilled water supply temperature as it exits the chiller compared to the temperature of the refrigerant within the evaporator. For example, the chilled water supply temperature might be 7 degrees Celsius or 44.6 degrees Fahrenheit, and the refrigerant might be at 3 degrees Celsius or 37.4 degrees Fahrenheit. The approach would therefore equal 4 degrees Celsius or 7.2 degrees Fahrenheit. A difference of 3 to 5 degrees Celsius or 5 to 8 degrees Fahrenheit is fairly typical. Set point or active chilled water set point. Set points within the chiller refers to a desired temperature or pressure, although this usually has a focus on the chilled water supply temperature. The desired temperature is defined within the controls and the chiller tries to meet this temperature. A temperature sensor at or near the chilled water supply outlet of the evaporator will measure the actual temperature and the chiller's controls will make adjustments to meet this or operate as close as possible to it. Chilled water pump and condenser water pumps. These are pumps which distribute the chilled and condenser water around the building between the chiller, the cooling coils, as well as the cooling tower. They can be either constant or variable flow depending on the design of the system. Variable flow is increasingly popular in secondary side systems as it can provide significant reduction in energy and operating costs. Flow rate. This is referring to the quantity of water passing through the chiller or through a specific part of the distribution pipework. It is a measurement of volume per unit time. For example, a gallon per minute, a liter per second, or a cubic meter per second. Mass flow rate. This is referring to the mass of water flowing through a chiller, a pump, or a specific point in the distribution pipework. It is a measurement of weight per unit of time, for example, pounds per minute or kilograms per second. Flow meter. A flow meter can be installed on chillers or chilled water systems to monitor the flow to and from each chiller or to measure the flow through the decoupler pipe to diagnose problems as well as ensure efficient operation. It is also used to signal a second chiller to start or stop. These are often clamp-on meters that use ultrasonic sensors to calculate the flow rate. Chiller tripped. This refers to the chiller turning off by itself through the internal controls due to a detected fault or it has reached the limits of a design set point. For example, a high or low pressure or temperature. The chiller therefore turns itself off to protect itself from damage. Coils. Coils refer to a heat exchanger. There are a few coils in a chiller and chilled water system. A cooling coil would mean the heat exchanger in an air handling unit or a fan coil unit which receives the chilled water and exchanges its cool into the air. A condenser coil would refer to the condenser of an air-cooled chiller which receives the hot high-pressure refrigerant and uses the ambient air to condense this into a liquid. Delta T. This refers to the temperature difference between the flow and return temperatures of either the chilled or condenser water. A typical temperature difference between the chilled water flow and return would be 6 degrees Celsius, but this can vary. A high delta T means the chiller is working hard and the efficiency should also be high, whereas a low delta T means that the chiller is likely operating inefficiently and there is likely design issues with the cooling system causing this. Superheat. This refers to the number of degrees Kelvin that the refrigerant is above the boiling point at a particular pressure. A reading of 4 to 8 degrees Kelvin is typical. If the reading is high, then the evaporator is not operating efficiently, and if it is low or zero, then there is a fault and it's possible that liquid refrigerant can reach the compressor, which will cause severe damage. Subcooling. This refers to a refrigerant which has been condensed and is at a temperature lower than its boiling point, so it is therefore in a liquid state. It is the difference in the refrigerant saturation temperature and the actual temperature of the liquid refrigerant. Expansion valve or device. This is a device used between the condenser and the evaporator. These cause a pressure reduction in the refrigerant as well as controlling the amount of refrigerant entering the evaporator, which is used to control the superheat. There are many different types used in chillers. Some examples of chiller expansion valves and devices are orifice plate, float valves, thermal expansion valves, electronic expansion valves, as well as pilot operated thermal expansion valves. Chilled water reset. This is a control strategy used to save energy. The strategy raises the chilled water supply temperature to reduce the lift, which will reduce the amount of work done by the compressor. This will also result in a higher return water temperature, which can lead to increased pump speeds in variable speed systems. It can also lead to low delta T syndrome and needs to be carefully analyzed before implemented. Lead and lag or duty and standby. The lead or duty refers to the chiller or pump, which is designated to be the first to turn on and handle the cooling load when a building utilizes multiple chillers. A lag or standby refers to the next chiller or pump which will turn on if the lead or duty is either unable to handle the full load or if the lead slash duty chiller or pump shuts down due to a fault. The lag slash standby will either join to provide more capacity or it will take over from the lead and duty. The designation of lead slash lag or duty slash standby will usually rotate to ensure equal run hours of all the equipment, or it will be designated according to the most efficient equipment running at the current operating conditions. Low profile. This is the cooling demand of the building plotted onto a chart showing the variations usually by hour covering a 24-hour period. The 24 hours can be either for a specific day or it can be averaged over a period of time, for example by seasonal demand, or for the total over a specific year, perhaps even just by weekday. This is very useful for engineers to analyze and can allow for better control strategies, energy efficiency, and energy forecasting. Package chiller. This refers to a chiller which comes from the manufacturer in one complete bundle with all the major refrigeration cycle components in one package. This is the most common type of chiller. They can include water or air-cooled design. Chiller economizer. An economizer is used in some centrifugal type chillers with two-stage compressors to reduce energy consumption. The design is fairly simple with a special tank placed between the condenser and the evaporator. The refrigerant is partly throttled into the tank and any refrigerant which vaporizes is sent straight to the second stage of the compressor. The rest of the refrigerant, which is at a liquid state, will continue to the evaporator. This reduces the work required by the compressor and thus saves energy. Primary and secondary. This is a common design method used for chilled water systems. It refers to the chillers being placed into one pipework loop and the cooling demand being placed into another second loop. Both are connected but have separate pumps. The pumps on the primary side which feed the chillers are typically constant speed, which the chillers prefer, and the pumps on the secondary side are typically variable speed. The chilled water is produced in the primary loop and the cooling load pulls this out in varying amounts on the secondary side to meet the varying cooling demand. Decoupler. This is common in primary secondary systems. It is a pipe placed at the end of a set of parallel connected chillers to hydraulically separate the primary and secondary sides and allows the secondary side to be variable flow. The chillers on the primary side will need to have a minimum flow rate to prevent damage. The decoupler allows chilled supply or return water to flow in either direction to satisfy the primary and secondary loop pumps. The flow rate through the decoupler will also determine whether a second chiller can be turned on or off. Free cooling. This refers to a cooling control strategy which rejects heat without or with minimal use of the compressor. This strategy can only be used in certain ambient conditions. It can be enabled when the outdoor air temperature is below the set point temperature. Some chillers have this function built in, others can be retrofitted, or the system can be modified to accommodate this. That about wraps things up, but just before I go, I want to thank Danfoss one last time for sponsoring this video. Don't forget to check out their wide range of chiller solutions over at chillers.danfoss.com. Okay, that's it for this video. Thank you very much for watching. I hope this has helped you and you've enjoyed it. If so, then please don't forget to like, subscribe, and share. And check us out on Facebook, Twitter, Google+, and of course, theengineeringmindset.com. Once again, thanks for watching.